Let's start. So I'm Mathieu Herb. I'm here not to talk as an OpenBSD developer, but more as an OpenBSD user in my regular day job. And this is why the logos here are not the OpenBSD or Xenocara or Wayland logos like for the other talk. So in my day job, I'm working as a research engineer at the LAS from CNRS. CNRS is a French public research agency. They cover a lot of different domains, from history to human science to mathematics, robotics, fundamental physics, and so on. And in my lab, we are working with mostly engineering science, from automation, computer science, robotics, and some microelectronics. And I'm working, I'm doing two things at my job. I did a PhD in robotics a long time ago, and I'm still working with the robotics team to provide the support for them with embedded systems. It's mostly Linux-based nowadays. And the rest of the time, I'm working for the general system administration of the lab, being more specifically in charge of security. I do also a few other things, like I said. But here, what here is interesting is the LAS, so my lab network, and what we are doing using OpenBSD firewalls there. So the LAS is a lab with around 650 permanent staff, plus a number of PhD students. There are approximately 100 PhD differences every year, and also a lot of interns. And globally, there are almost 300 people arriving and 300 people leaving the lab each year. So it's a lot of turnover. As I said earlier, we have six research departments with various areas of research. And this is all powered by a set of machines that we host in our own machine room. We have storage servers, several virtualization clusters running either VMware or Proxmox. We have some dedicated computer clusters, some backup servers, and so on. And globally, for all the people, we have around 2,000 end devices connected to the network, whether it's a workstation, laptops, mobile phones, tablets, and several research equipments. Inside our lab, we have some security-sensitive projects that have some specific needs in terms of security, not only on the computer and network point of view, but also physical security and so on. And we have been using OpenBSD firewalls since almost 15 years, since 2009. I presented this a first time in French in 2011. If you get the slides, this is a link to the presentation I did in 2011. And another interesting thing is that even though we are some of the old labs with a lot of IPv4 space, we have a /16. We have also decided to deploy IPv6 since a long time. We started in 2004. And so all the things that I'm going to present here need to work with both IPv4 and IPv6. And there have been some interesting things in the past, but nowadays it's almost completely transparent. We also use OpenBSD for other stuff at LAS in order to try to get some critical mass. And I will come back to that in the conclusion. But for me, it's important that I'm not the only one, the only OpenBSD hacker that knows how those systems work. It's important to teach other people in the sysadmin team how to install, how to upgrade, how to fix things in OpenBSD. So one of the way to achieve this is to have many different services depending on OpenBSD so that many people get involved in using, installing, upgrading OpenBSD. So we run our DNS servers, both the authoritative servers and the caching servers on OpenBSD virtual machines. We run our SMTP servers under OpenBSD, our NTP servers using OpenNTPD, our DHCP server running the OpenBSD DHCP server. I'm not talking about this in details in those slides, but the link between the OpenBSD DHCP server and PF, where it is able to publish the leads in a PF table so that you can block all the non-allocated IPs using PF is quite nice. We have a Squid web proxy and some ArtWatch probes also all running on OpenBSD. A very simplified architecture of our network looks like that. We are connected to the internet through RENATER, the French Higher Education and Research Network, the French branch of Géant. then we have some DMZ area, demilitarized zone, even though we are not a military research lab, but trying to find another name didn't work too well. I'm trying to say half open zone or something like that, but it doesn't work. Anyway, and then we have a main internal firewall, and both of them are running the setup that I'm going to show in the next slides. So a pair of redundant CARP OpenBSD networks, and we have some auxiliary routers. For the visitors, the firewall is also OpenBSD based, but not redundant. And we have a VPN server, which is running Linux for reason outside of my scope. So in this talk, I'm done almost with the general presentation of LAS. Now I'm going to focus on some quick reminders on PF and CARP, and then show you how we configure the stuff using routing domains, which is somehow interesting. Then I'm going to give some feedback on our current experience with those systems. And the last part, I'm going to show you a way to experiment with this, with a setup that you can run under VMM, the OpenBSD Virtual Machine Manager, to experiment on an OpenBSD laptop with three VMs to test stuff in a setup that is quite quite near from the production setup. So when you are running a pair of firewalls using CARP, there is one major issue that we have faced for a number of years at the beginning, is that the inactive firewall, the one that is back, in the backup state at a given level, does not have any network access, because both its outgoing and its ingress interfaces at the CARP level are down. And for the ingress interface, you may get around by allocating a specific address to this port, but on the outside port, it's not even possible. RENATER doesn't allow us to have several public IP addresses on the external port, so we have only the public CARP address. And we will see in this. Organization there, this firewall is even trickier, because since we have many, many interfaces, managing a separate IP address for the management for both firewalls can be quite tricky. So basically, this is what I'm saying in this slide. And for all of this, the routing domain notion is a quite nice approach to fix this issue. The idea of the routing domains in OpenBSD, for those who don't know, is a way to separate completely a set of routing tables from a given set of interfaces and to isolate them from the others. So each process in the system is bound to a routing domain and a number of routing tables, but generally you just have one routing table per routing domain. And so here, for example, it's something that gets near to what we are doing. We have one routing domain dedicated to routing. So we have two interfaces in this domain, and the processes that are needed there only see those two interfaces. And another routing domain dedicated to administration with other processes that only see this EM2 interface and not the two other ones. And if you want to use routing domains, some quick reminders. You specify what is the routing domain attached to an interface, or more correctly, which interface is attached to which routing domain in the hostname.ef file by adding the air domain n being the number of the air domain that you want to attach to this interface. You can figure out what is the current routing domain for a process, well, for your current shell, using ID minus R. And route dash TN exec allows you to exec to launch a new process attached to a specific routing domain specified by the N here. You can also list all the processes with the associated routing table with PX dash O R table. And for the general startup of the daemons, you can specify the routing daemon in which daemon will run by specifying the option set daemon airtable n, and this will write the pf the rc.conf.local file with the correct options. And if you need to move packets between routing domain, which is normally forbidden, you can use PF with a specific syntax for this. So if we want to use this to solve our firewall problem, we can just copy the design of the large routers from Juniper, Cisco, or whatever by creating one specific routing plane or routing domain and one specific administration domain or routing domain for the control and administration. And the control plane will always have a default route that is accessible. And the data plane will be either active or inactive and may lose its access, but we don't care. And the idea is to use the routing domain zero, so the default routing domain for the admin part, so that it's as transparent as possible for the user. When you log into your router, in fact, you don't see the data plane. You only see the process that are in the admin part of the router, and you can do normal sysadmin stuff, applying patches, and so on. So, in practice, this gives this this schema with two routers. In violet, we have the data plane, and in red, we have the admin routing domain. And so, basically, I will show this figure a second time a bit later. But we have the pfsync interfaces here. We have the external interfaces there. Creating a CARP group zero with both IPv4 and IPv6 addresses, the internal CARP one with their with their non-routable IPv4 address and some IPv6 address that is routable, and the LAN and another LAN for the administration. When you want to install this kind of configuration, it's not very, very difficult. You start by just connecting the interface that is going to be used for the administration, and then you install OpenBSD from USB key, CD-ROM, image, or whatever normally. And you configure only this interface. So in my case, in the figure that I showed before, it's the VIO3. The interface, and once you have installed the machines, then you can configure the rest the routing domain one with the CARP interfaces, PF and so, PF sync and so on. And you can also prepare a new firewall completely offline. You just need to configure it using its routing domain zero. And you can pre-configure everything in the routing domain one. It's not connected yet, but there is no problem. It will not have any packets to handle. So you can write all the CARP PF sync interfaces, your PF rules and everything. And then when everything is ready, you just connect it and it will start routing packets. So in order to try to be useful, I've showed all the configuration. I'm not going to go into all the details. We first have a sysctl.conf to enable CART preemption and packet forwarding. Then we set up the various physical interfaces. The VIO 0 and VIO 1 are just passively brought up in the routing domain 1 with these two lines. VIO 2, which is used for PF sync, we will set a set of IPv4 non-routable address for PF sync. PF sync transport currently only works with IPv4, so yeah. A good thing. So here we don't. And we don't really care since it's a short local link. It could even run with something else than IP. It would work too. Then we can set up the CARP interfaces on both routers. So CARP 0, CARP 1. Here I've picked up some example addresses for both interfaces, both IPv4, IPv6. And the only thing that is a bit specific and that you need to figure out is that the real default route using your uplink provider, you cannot use etc MyGate to specify that because this is going to be used by the routing domain zero. So you need to add Shibang commands to execute the route commands to set up the default route for IPv4 and IPv6. On the internal interface, there is no default route, it's easier. The second router is exactly the same except for the AdvSQ parameter, so that the second router stays inactive as much as possible, but the rest is exactly the same. If it's not, it's a mistake on my side. Then you set up PFSync, it's the same file on both routers. You just say that it's in routing domain one and that it's using VIO 2 as the interface below. Then I've put some simple pf.conf file here, but it's really trivial and simple. If you want to have more insight into writing good PF rules, there was a nice tutorial a few days later, earlier. So I'm not going into those details. Hmm? There's a book as well. Yeah, and there is Peter's book. And, and then you may want to run some services on the data plane. For example, if you want to use this for a simple SOHO-like config, home or small office router, then you may want to run DHCPD, RAD for IPv6, unbound to get some caching DNS server, and maybe NTP to get some clock synchronization for your LAN. So here the only new thing is that you need to think about starting them in the routing domain one, so that they are actually those services are actually visible by your internal machines. Yes, DHCPD in OpenBSD also has some nice redundancy feature that allows you to tell which one is the master, which one is the slave DHCP server. So this is those minus Y options there. Just read the doc. So once we have done that, we have something that works at last using this kind of setups, some feedback about what we are doing. The external firewalls are physical machines. Currently, there are Dell Air 340. Those machines are way too big for what they are doing. But given the structure of a public market, when you work in a public research institute, it's difficult to buy smaller machines. So this is what we got. We are using Intel X710, 10 gigabytes, using SFP plus ports for the packet forwarding, so the external and the connection to our DMZ, and Intel X550 cards with copper interfaces for the PF sync and the management, the interface in routing domain zero. And our PF rule set is about 320 rules, which is not that much, but still, given the number of workstations using this firewall, there is about 40,000 states in the firewall at every time during the day. The internal firewalls are a bit more interesting because we decided a few years ago to completely virtualize them. So they are running on our VMware infrastructure using a lot of VLANs to separate all the internal traffic. In practice, we have 26 VLANs currently in our LAN connected to those two virtual machines. So this provides a number of an impressive level of redundancy, because when a virtual machine crashes, VMware is able to either move it to another hypervisor or to restart it. Then we have the redundancy with CARP. So it's really hard to have something completely broken there. The rules in the internal firewalls are a bit smaller, but not much. And also they run about the same number of states in general production. And currently we are running OpenBSD 7.3 stable, so the latest stable version on all those four machines. Our PF wall set basically blocks everything inbound and only allows some specific traffic to web servers, SSH servers, some specific services open to only to some of our partners. And so on, and lets most of the egress traffic going out. We are doing something about people doing brute force attacks on passwords by using the max con rate to slow them down by moving them to the to a specific table where they are blocked for 1 hour, and that works pretty well. We also have some custom fail-to-ban rules. Then, when a fail-to-ban server running on a Linux machine figure out someone who is doing too much traffic, it can ask PF to block this address rather than using a local IP filter rule. And we are losing PF log also to log some of the traffic that our upper management asks us to log on outbound traffic. I wrote a small script that is completely trivial to check the syntax of PF rules and to copy the pf.conf rule to the secondary firewall if everything is okay. It's just something that everyone needs, so I decided to put it on a slide so that it can be reused. With IPv6, our rule sets get a bit bigger because we have to duplicate the rules for both IPv4 and IPv6 address for each service that is allowed or banned. I hope that sometimes we will be able to unplug IPv4, but it's not coming very fast, so I don't know. There is one thing that I didn't investigate too much, but basically the CARP keep alive packets are running both in IPv4 and IPv6, and this is a bit redundant. I don't know if it's if it would be possible to only run one of the two protocols, but well, it's not that much traffic, and it does, it's not really a problem. PFSync is IPv4 only. And the other thing that used to be a problem but works better now is that RID doesn't like to listen on an interface that is down. And so I needed at some point, but I think it's not the case anymore, but I forgot to recheck. I needed some IFSightD rules to start RID on the secondary firewall whenever it becomes the main one. Because otherwise the RID daemon, so the router advertisement daemon for IPv6 dies when the firewall is inactive. Some words about the use of CARP. You want redundancy, but what exactly do we need redundancy for? In fact, the hardware is so much reliable that the redundancy to prevent hardware failure is not really an issue. In 15 years, we have almost never experienced any kind of hardware failure where CARP could have helped. In fact, CARP is just something very, very comfortable to be able to upgrade firewalls without interrupting the traffic, to be able to do some tests on a machine. Or at the beginning, at least 15 years ago, we still had a number of bugs in OpenBSD, and from time to time, the main router would just freeze. But it's not a problem. The second one would take over, and it just need to someone to notice that we switched to the backup router to actually reset the main one so that it start again. But in the recent years, I never saw such kind of freeze, and it's not needed anymore. Well, it may come back at some point, given all the hard work that OpenBSD is doing to unlock the network stack to allow it to run on several CPUs. Maybe there will be some bugs in the future again, but really thinking about CARP for hardware failure, first, it's much more harder than you think, because there are a lot of other single point of failure in a typical setup with switches and so on. And in practice, it's not really the issue. We had one strange bug where our upstream provider router stopped to answer ARP requests, and so it lost IPv4 connectivity, but IPv6 was still okay, and the CARP packet would still work because of the of the rate where they are exchanged the ARP address for those would never expire. And well, CARP was not useful in this case. We really needed to have the operator reboot his switch so that ARP would start again. During our 15 years, we went from a single attachment configuration to a double attachment, so we have also a bit more redundancy on the upstream links. Here we are using two different paths for the fibers, because this was at Toulouse one of our main source of stress is that this link here goes through a bridge that was under heavy constructions for several years, and almost every morning we were fearing that someone would cut the fibers in the bridge. And so now we have another pass, and they can cut the fiber in the bridge. We don't care anymore. But still, the CARP packets are not going this way; they are just going this way. So we don't really test the availability of the upstream routers. And to conclude, I just want to present some setup that you can run on an OpenBSD machine with two virtual machines for the two routers, plus one extra virtual machine to emulate a client in the LAN, and that allows you to run this on your laptop. I have an almost working setup on my laptop that I redid yesterday evening, but I probably don't have time to try to show it. So it's again the same diagram that the one I presented earlier. with two virtual machines. This is why earlier I used the VIOI as the interface names. And basically, you just need to set up vm.conf that will define the three switches. I'm using VEB here, the new virtual interface bridge written by DLG. But it also works with regular bridges. I think that VEB is just a bit lighter than regular bridges for this, so I'll just use VEB. So I have the external switch, the internal switch, and the PF sync switch with VEB012. Then the VM configuration for the first router. Well, nothing fancy here, just three interfaces connected to the three bridges that we defined earlier, and one local interface, which is going to be the LAN interface for management. Well, pardon, sorry, the management interface. And I am the owner of this VM, so I don't need to run duas or anything to start them. I can just start VMCTL as Mathieu on the machines. Exactly the same file for router B with just the name of the image that changes and the name of the machine. And basically, that's it. I showed you the configuration files that you need on both routers earlier. And you can start the VMs, and we have some working setup. And so to conclude, running OpenBSD firewalls in my lab has been quite successful for almost 15 years. For now, we see no reason to change this. We are now on a 10 gigabits uplink, but for us, performance is not really an issue. The current state of the traffic is that we are around 1 gigabit average on a day. Sometimes we go up to 2 or 3 gigabits, but not much more. And for this, our OpenBSD firewalls running on either on the Dell machines or the internal ones running on our VMware infrastructure are perfect. We cannot see anything where we could say, okay, this is where it's PF that's limiting our performance. If that should happen, we know that there are solutions. We can try to run active firewalls, or we can switch to FreeBSD. No, I know, I don't want to, but we have added a few DDoS attacks that were successfully blocked. That means that we saw the huge amount of incoming traffic, but nothing on outgoing traffic. It was still going fine. I really like all the tools bound to PF to look at the traffic, to look at the states and so on. It really helps figuring out what are the data flux. The flows, that are going in and out for debugging purposes and so on. It's nice. It's text-based, but it makes things easier to parse by to write some tools, some scripts, to do some statistics and so on. And as I said, one of the main concerns for the sustainability of this kind of setup is to get staff that knows about OpenBSD and is able to do some things when I'm not here, or since I'm coming closer and closer to the retirement, when I won't be there anymore. I hope that I will not just switch everything to some Palo Alto or other expensive stuff, that they can still continue running this. And also, when we need to replace the machines, it's always a bit difficult to make sure that the new hardware is going to be compatible with OpenBSD. For example, the current one, the Intel 700-something cards, when we set up them, we needed to run OpenBSD Current, the stable version, but that time didn't support those cards. So for a few numbers of months, we were running Current and upgrading every week. Until the release that supported it came out. And I don't know for the next generation of 10 or 20 gig cards that we will need to buy. And basically, that's it. If you have questions. Yes, Henning.
So I'm a bit surprised about the hardware issue, because I have not run into a single piece of server hardware in like a decade that caused problems. So at worst, you may be forced to run current for a couple of months.
Yeah. Well, I have also for the mail server, we have a physical machine, and the latest one that we bought in the always with the constraints of our public markets has some Broadcom cards that are not supported at all, so I needed to buy another Intel-based PCI card to replace the Broadcom one. And I know that whenever I'm going to call the support, they will say, well, but there is an unsupported card in this machine. It's normal that it's broke. So I need to think to remove the Intel cards to run the DIAGs.
And I find that use of routing domains really interesting, because as you say, that basically gets you to a state like the really, really, really big routers that separate control and administrate packet flow. So that's actually really interesting and really good. You can usually get around the reachability issue by assigning more IP addresses if you have them, which is a limitation. And you're totally right, you gotta look at the entire setup, because I very often see setups where the OpenBSD machines are redundant, but the switches are not. Guess what dies?
Any other question?
Do you use anything for version management of your firewall configs and stuff like that for change tracking or?
Yes. For this, we use Git, but not in a very clever way. We just commit things locally to Git and push it to a remote repository to archive them. But then all the commits are done by root, which is not optimal, but.
Do you use anything but conventions and processes to keep the redundant firewalls in sync configuration-wise?
Well, mostly the script that I show you that is used to upgrade the rules. We never edit anything on the secondary firewall. We just edit them on the main one and push to the one using my script, knowing that the script is available on both machines. So if for some extended period of time we need to use the backup switch, it will try to push it to the master switch. But this is also not perfect. If one of the firewalls is down for too long, then you will need to resynchronize them manually when it comes back. But well, since it's something that almost never happened in 15 years,
thanks, Matt, for the talk. Just a quick question. You know, when you're syncing between the A and the B firewall, how do you deal with different interface name configs or different IP addresses, you know, on the individual?
Well, since we bought both machines at the same time, they have exactly the same hardware, so the interface names are the same.
What I meant was like different IPs, you know, the real IPs and the systems being subtly different.
Well, this doesn't appear anywhere in our rules. So our rules just have the CARP addresses or IP addresses from the different services.
Thank you. Merci beaucoup.
So.
Do you make use of PF anchors to keep your different parts of a rule set organized?
Not in those cases. I'm using anchors on the visitors firewall because we have some constraint to shut up this network outside the works hour, and so there is an anchor there that is used to shut down the.
There is a use of anchors that almost nobody makes use of, but that I absolutely love. The anchor statement is a regular PF rule. You can put all kinds of statements on there, like anchor foo from, or anchor foo to port 80. That one is actually pretty good for performance because you only enter that anchor for, let's say you have an anchor for your web servers. So you'll only enter the anchor for port 80 and 443, and inside the anchor you just list the IP addresses or stuff like that, right? So almost nobody does that, but it's super convenient. The most convenient one is a very, very early anchor, anchor quick, catching all the packets to the local machine.
I prefer to use one anchor per routing domain or per address family.
That's something to try for perhaps for our next talk.
Right. I think we're out of time, so let's thank Rusty.